welcome to yet another spooky, scary, wine-filled episode of Two Guys and a Lot of Wine. We do have three guys tonight. Thanks for joining me. I'm Bobby P., and I have another wonderful guest who's been on the show a few times, Mr. Jordan Stein, executive chef of both the Pond House and the Pond House Grill, and a very good friend and neighbor of mine who really started it all, Mr. Steve Adler.
Please.
Thank you, guys.
Hey, good to be here.
Thank you, Jordan.
Awesome time, Bobby.
Now, the reason this show is going to be scary is because I figured I've never done a Halloween-themed wine show before. And you got to figure, Halloween, people don't think of wine as a Halloween-type treat, right? It's Halloween, you drink beer, wine, you don't think of it. I, however, found three wines that I think exemplify Halloween. And the three tonight are going to be either very good or possibly very bad, which actually goes with Halloween because, you know.
That's scary.
It's scary.
It's a
scary trick,
not a treat. Yeah.
And the order procession of the wines is going to be the best champagne sparkling wine in Russia from Latvia. Or is it Latvia?
All I know is there's no borscht.
Lithuania. I'm sorry. From Lithuania, their favorite celebratory sparkling wine, and Sovietsku Iglustu. And whether or not that's going to make us have detente right here in the studio, I do not know, but we'll let our taste buds decide.
Great.
Then we're going to be drinking a Francis Ford Coppola Moscato. And even though it looks like a rosé, it could be considered a rosé, but it's not really.
It's the godfather of all wines.
It is the. I did not think of that one.
Very good. I haven't even started drinking it.
Well, I figured Moscato.
That's great.
That was good.
It was.
It would be something like, I'm Dracula, I drink Moscato. So it has a nice role. So if you're going to a Halloween party and you're dressed up, you want to bring a Moscato if you're dressed like a vampire.
Dracula.
And my favorite, actually, I shouldn't say my favorite, but one of my favorite wines, I was fortunate enough to have discovered this when I was in Hungary, and that's Bull's Blood. It's 17th century wine, still made the same way from the Eger Hills of Hungary. And so nice little story behind that. And if you're showing up at a Halloween party with something called Bull's Blood, you're going to get some attention.
Sounds good. Let's start drinking.
Let's start drinking.
Okay.
Sounds good.
All right. So our first, like I said, our first bubbly tonight, kind of difficult to find. You can do a little search online. I'll put this up, of course, on our webpage. And champagne or sparkling in Russia has been around just as long there as it has been in other parts of the world. But they make it a little bit different. They're a little bit heavier on the sweeter side, not so much on the Blanc side. But the Russians love it. Now, I could already see there's not a lot of effervescence in this. I don't know.
So let me ask you a question.
Sure.
Being that most of my beverages are probably from a solo cup, what am I looking at in a wine when I pick it?
Well, actually, it's very interesting because they do say this is very floral. This has a really nice bouquet right off the bat. Now, to me, I can smell this before I even put it up close to
it. It smells sweet.
It does smell sweet. And this, in a way, could be more of an aperitif, maybe sort of like a heavier wine you would drink after dinner with dessert. That may be something you would drink prior to a celebratory thing, in my opinion. But I haven't tasted it yet. So here's the first taste.
My second taste.
Maybe we should.
Cheers.
Here we go.
There's not much effervescence in this really at all.
Very little bubbles.
It's actually a little sort of like an apple cider type flavor to it.
Almost a vino verde has more spritz than this.
It does, which is why it's surprising because they do call it a sparkling. Mm. There's not a lot of sparkling here. So what do you think, Steve? I know you're a big champagne guy.
Yeah, you know, it's sweet. It doesn't really have an aftertaste. And so what can I eat with this?
Well, you could have crackers and cheese. And actually, as you can see, I put a few crackers down just in case this wine from Russia was so bad, we needed to coat our mouth with some bread.
I think that it's something that you don't particularly need to eat with food. What I would like to do with this is make it into some kind of sparkling champagne cocktail and have it before dinner. And maybe because it is so florally, maybe add on to that floral pattern and put some elderflower or some lavender. You can go any route you want. It would also be great with some type of stone fruit in there, whether it was a puree or some kind of liqueur. And I think a splash of soda water might be good to just liven it up a little bit.
Now it could be, because once again, I've never had this sparkling before. I happened to find it in actually New Britain, which has a large Polish population, somewhat of a Russian population, they have really eclectic bottles on the shelf. And this one was recommended to me as, like I said, being one of the favorite celebratory sparklings in Russia.
I like it.
However, and this is an example, it's never happened on the show before, Jordan, is that bottle could be a tad bit flat.
It might be. I think it is really flat.
And but it still has a flavor, but this could be an example, and it's the first time it's ever happened on the show. That
where it's no good.
I'm not going to say no good, but there's not much effervescence here. So can we call this a sparkling tonight? I don't know.
I wouldn't call it a sparkling.
I would think...
I think you're sparkling, though.
Do you know what it is? Not to get political, but maybe this is an example of Soviet Russia. Quality standards aren't as up to par as like we are in the United States, and the bottle was not probably sealed properly.
Oh, man.
Well, you know.
Bold statement.
So in the holiday feeling of Halloween, scary because it's flat, scary because quality control, but thumbs up just because there's alcohol in it.
So I got a question for you. What are we talking on a price point here?
The price point of this is under $12.
That's my kind of wine.
Yeah. There's not a lot to choose from if you actually do some searching online for Russian sparkling,
okay,
which I did. There's maybe four or five varietals that are available here in the United States.
Now, do they do it in the same process that they would in France?
Believe it or not, they do. Champagne and sparkling went through quite a change under communism. Prior to that, during the Tsar's time and leading up to the Tsar, wine and champagne was pretty much made the same way as it was in other parts of Europe. Under the Soviet rule, once again, quality controls were changed. They went to cheaper varietals of wine, or cheaper varietals of grape, and didn't process it quite as efficiently. Just one pour for now.
I'm a public servant.
Well, I got to say, for somebody who didn't like it that much, you're going for the second pour already.
Well, you know, my wife's driving tonight, so...
In conclusion about that, once the wall fell, the vineyards and the companies that make Russian champagne have slowly improved back up to the standards that they thought they had prior to Soviet or communistic rule.
Okay.
So, once again, I think we just got a bad bottle tonight, personally. Even though there's no bubbles in it, it's got a flavor.
I'm going to go thumbs, like, in the middle. I don't think it's great. I don't think it's bad either, but I think it has potential if you want to add a couple of things or use your imagination to get it somewhere else to where it needs to be. But once again, you go into a party and the label looks like that, and that's pretty neat.
Well, like I said, that's one of the reasons I brought it, because if you are going to a Halloween party, and we all go to Halloween parties. I know me and my wife love dressing up and going to Halloween parties. You want to bring something that's a little different, and different.
You know, I would agree with you, Jordan. I mean, if you put something sparkling in here, it really would kind of just bring out the flavor.
It would. It has nothing. It can't hide anything. It can't hide behind anything. And the flavor is definitely pleasant.
Yeah.
So let's move on to the next one, Bob. Yeah.
Great. Now, the next one is a Francis Ford Coppola, and for those of you who know somewhat about wine, Coppola makes quite a lot of wines at a wide variety of price points. And the Moscato, which similar to rosé, the type of grape it is, you know, depending on the color, Moscato can be a white color. It can be this color we see here. It's actually one of the oldest grapes in the world. And actually, the Moscato grape was actually found in King Midas's tomb. So a lot of people say that when they drink a Moscato, they're drinking the wine of royalty.
And the golden touch.
You guys are so knowledgeable.
I've actually enjoyed a lot of Coppola's wines over the years.
I was going to say, what region were these?
Well, the Moscato in particular is from Italy.
Okay.
Coppola's vineyards are in California.
Okay.
So this is a California Moscato, but the grapes themselves are still a Moscato grape.
Italy.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And the reason I brought this for a Halloween-themed show is because, once again, and I have to do it again, if you're Dracula, you drink Moscato. It just has a nice ring. So if you're showing up to a Halloween party, I think that's a great name for a wine.
It's a lot easier than saying Manischewitz during I think the way you... Can you say that again? Moscato? Or
do you want me to do the whole thing? I'm Dracula, and I drink Moscato.
Okay.
See how nice that is?
I like that.
That's
can you
nice.
Do anything with Manischewitz? I don't think so.
No, you can. You can actually hurt yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So what we have here, nice color. Should be a really luscious bouquet. Actually, almost a blood color for things.
Almost.
It even looks like a Zin a little bit, doesn't it?
Don't say that word.
Okay.
Red Zin is good on this show.
Okay.
Just white Zin, you'd never say
that. We'll just move along. Let's keep rolling.
Now, this is sweet, but I like it.
I like it too.
Yeah.
But I think you were on our show last month and we had a rosé. I think it was the Barron Crown from California. Mm. And this is also from California. And I think Coppola's vineyards are in that same whole, you know, area.
Is it my imagination or it seems a little heavy?
It is a little heavy. This actually probably would pair well with cheese or fruit.
Absolutely. But it could also stand up to quite a bit of things. And I would go out on a limb and say that it could even hold up against some grilled salmon, which is probably the boldest way to eat salmon when you're trying to pair it with wines. And so it's it really holds its own. And I see from the legs, there's a moderate to light alcohol content, and it's very crispy. And it has a very short finish.
It does.
Which is not something most Moscatos finish a little bit longer than that. So it's very interesting.
And I know, Steve, you do drink wine, but I know
I do.
You like a little bit on the sparkling side more than just straight wine like this. But, you know, I know you're a gin man. Like, I like my gin too. But something like this, you could sort of drink this slow while you're maybe having a cigar or something like that.
Yeah, I would agree with both of you. I mean, it has a nice finish to it. There's no real after, bite to it. And it's, it just seems like it's very smooth, very, very nice. Semi-sweet.
Yeah, semi-sweet. It's not overly sweet. I think semi-sweet is probably a good way to describe this wine. And once again, I really like a lot of the Coppola wines that are on the market right now. And this particular one, it's very reasonable for, quote-unquote, a mild, low alcohol. I think it's 10.5 alcohol on the Moscato. Mm-hmm. And it's a scary wine because a lot of people, they see a Moscato on the, they don't know what that is. I mean,
Or they hear it on the radio and then they go out and buy it just because of the grape varietal.
That's true.
It seems to be very popular right now in the hip-hop world.
You're telling me something I did not know.
Yeah, very popular.
Now, see, that's why Jordan's on the show tonight. I thought Moscato was something that most people are not familiar with at all.
Yes, I'm a true hip-hopper.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to give this one the thumb up. Definitely.
I like this one.
I like this.
Also, thumbs up for me, too.
And another reason people might like to try this wine, besides the fact that the alcohol is a little bit on the lower side, I think if you are at a party, and once again, I talk a lot about bringing wine to parties because, as my guests know, Jordan, Steve, I have a lot of parties. And, I like having wine that's both accessible and easy to drink and not too overly complex, especially if I have a lot of people over. And if you're having a party or going to a party, this is a perfect wine because it's not going to offend people and they're going to probably enjoy it.
Absolutely.
Do you have any Moscato on your menu at either restaurant?
We have Moscato in Glastonbury, but not in West Hartford.
Oh, do you know what it is, what your varietal is?
Don't remember offhand, no.
Do you know if it's a cellar? Do people still buy it at the restaurant?
Sometimes they do. In fact, we also feature, during happy hour, we feature the Moscato grape. It's, we're ever changing and evolving everything over there. And what's really interesting is now that we moved from paper menus to the tablet menus.
Which are great, by the way.
So we can make changes all the time. So if something comes in that's exciting, we can bring it in and then swap it out. Nice. So it makes it pretty convenient.
Have you had a lot of positive feedback on the tablets?
A lot. And also, we're saving a ton of paper and ink, which is always good too. So, Absolutely. It's six and one and a half a dozen in the other because you still have to plug them in, you still have to charge them up, so it's still energy. But at the end of the day, we're getting really, really good feedback from the tablet menus.
And those things hold up with a charge the whole night?
They hold for the whole day, for lunch and dinner. And then we have a charging base that we put them in overnight, and then they're ready to go in the morning.
Well, speaking of ready to go, now we're in for the really Halloween-themed, bloody, serious-sounding wine. And that is the Bull's Blood from Hungary. And this particular red, like I said, I found this myself personally when I had the fortune of spending some time in the Hungary, Budapest region. This is the most popular red wine in Hungary. It's also not one of the oldest. I think it's been around since the 16th century. And I'll get into where the Bull's Blood name comes from after we pour it.
Nice.
This wine should technically sit for an hour before you pour it and drink it.
This is a half-hour show, so what do we do?
Right. I tried to open it up earlier, but I think it's only been open for about 25 minutes.
Okay.
There was a lot of traffic on the way here. That's why.
So as we're letting this, I would imagine,
we'll let it sit in the glass
settle.
For a minute, yeah?
So we can have this with...
Oh, this is going to pair
the chef,
with
so.
a lot of things.
This is going to go anywhere.
Anywhere?
Anything big.
Absolutely.
I haven't even tasted it, but
I mean,
the nose and the color. You're going anywhere with this one.
Massive amounts of this with either chicken papakash when I was in Hungary or any type of a red meat.
Galumpkis?
I'm not a galumpki fan.
You went to Hungary? You didn't have a galumpki?
I ate mostly chicken papakash. I could not get enough. I love, first of all, I like going to restaurants saying, I would like some chicken papakash. And even though I still spoke in my American accent, you say papakash and there's a lot of ways.
God bless you.
Papakash. Well, okay. Thank you very much, Steve.
Okay.
But how it got its name is very interesting.
What does that mean, by the way? Papakash.
Do we know? It means give me some good food.
Is that what it is? Okay. It sounds like something I probably can't even say this on community.
Just remember, there's no borscht in the champagne room.
There isn't.
That is the line of the
night. I feel like, have you ever been to the Concord? Remember the Concord? You're too young for the Concord.
I'm not really from Connecticut, so
I
don't know.
Remember the borscht belt and the whole
Pocono? No, but it sounds good because
it was wonderful.
You could have borscht with this wine
right
here. Could you?
Really?
Absolutely.
Adler's borscht. Mrs. Adler's borscht.
I don't know Mrs. Adler, but I know Mrs. Astor.
Oh, okay. Do you remember Adler's borscht?
No.
Oh, okay. All right.
No, but I know Mrs. Astor's chicken
And there was Mrs.
Salad.
Adler's gefilte fish, too.
I love gefilte fish.
Listen.
So gefilte fish and horseradish in this wine, you're in.
Actually, anything along that depth.
Anything big and peppery and spicy and bold, right?
Yeah.
Well, how this got its name is during the siege of Edgar Castle in the 17th century. The Turkish soldiers who were trying to conquer Edgar Castle eventually gave up. And the reason they gave up is they said they must have been pouring bull's blood in the wine that the defenders were drinking because they've put up such a stiff resistance. And that name stuck, and the wine was labeled bull's blood from then on. And let's see if we turn into Raging Bulls ourselves after a couple sips.
Now, is Raging Bull a Coppola movie?
Scorsese.
Oh,
right. Who knows?
All right, so
this has a very, we had the Russian block wine, we had the Coppola, and then this, it's a very different, distinct taste.
But they're completely, they're different grapes, that's off the bat, but it tastes, for me, it tastes nothing like it smells like.
It, once again, Jordan, I want to say that they specifically say that this wine should breathe an hour before.
In the glass or in a decanter or just open?
I would, personally, when I have had this, it's been decantered. Mm-hmm. So it usually has had a chance to open up more. But I think the flavor profile of this will probably change.
And they're in the region of grapes where this came from?
That is the Eger region of Hungary.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. So again, price point. So if we...
The Coppola, once again, under $12.
Nice.
And the Bull's Blood, depending on where you buy it locally, it could be anywhere between high 15s, 12, sometimes lower than that. The price varies a lot. Why that is, I don't know. I've seen it for in the $9 range. I've seen it in the $12 range. Mm-hmm. It really depends on where you buy it and what the markup is on it.
From a restaurant, because you are the chef of the Pond House and it's such a great place, do you see a lot of these types of wines coming into the restaurant?
You know, one of the beauty of being at the Pond House is having folks come in and popping, bringing their own stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very fortunate to be able to taste amazing things. They always seem to leave a couple of ounces for the chef. It is a great job.
Yeah.
Very, very fortunate. Something like this... Unless you're, now, I have friends who bring four or five bottles, and then they...
I've never done that. Not just with me and my wife.
But, and they're going for the gamut, so they'll pop. But most of the time, if it's a birthday or a holiday, people will bring a really big, expensive something they've been laying down for a while and trying to save. Mm-hmm. I had the opportunity recently, and we were just talking about it, to do an 18-year Grange vertical. Which it was just out of this world amazing, very rare to even, and they went back from 75 all the way up to 94, and it was incredible. But anyway, something like this, I don't really see that much, and we don't see we see a lot of big California, we see a lot of France, we see some really, really nice stuff. Nothing oddball Halloween like this. I think that, the cat kind of gets into the way, and...
Yeah,
But it doesn't.
By the way, folks in West Hartford, this is not a real cat.
It is not. It's not a real cat that I killed.
Nobody's been harmed,
stuffed.
And these grapes have been under very good treatment. So,
but Jordan, just to emphasize your point, I mean, technically, yeah, it's a scary wine, bull's blood for Halloween, But at the same time, you know, it's a wine and a grape variety. It's actually a blend of a lot of different grapes. But it's actually a wine that could still, I think, be accessible to most people if they just gave it a shot.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's very easy drinking. And the nose is not so easy. The nose is very complex. But it drinks very, very easy. In fact, I don't know that I would put this, now that I've tasted it, I don't know that I would put this up against something huge and big. I think that you would have to go maybe, I mean, you could still grill things and it doesn't matter what the protein is. But I wouldn't go up against Gorgonzola or some Stilton. I just don't think it would hold up. It doesn't have that tannin in the back to fight that.
So I have a question.
Okay.
And this is great because I haven't seen Jordan in a while and I've got all these chef questions. We only have a half hour, right?
That's right.
Okay, so I'll speed it. So are we really pairing food to wine lately, or is there just kind of more of an open mind
to... It's a really, really good question.
Because I'm a steak eater.
Okay.
But I'm like, you know, I do like white, you know, Zen. Sorry, I know what I'm...
That's okay. You're forgiven.
But tell me the kind of the rules of the road.
There's in my book, you drink what you drink because you like it. You eat what you eat because you like it. There are no rules. But this is something that you don't have to go by the rules. You make your own rules. Just like in life, you make your own rules. But at the end of the day, this would get lost if you eat something really, really big with it. Mm. Now, it'll be great. It'll be great to wet your palate and bring it down, but it's going to get lost. It's not going to hold up.
Well, that's probably why I enjoyed it with chicken paprikash, because chicken paprikash, even though they had that paprika in it, it wasn't really an overly spicy meal.
Well, Hungarian paprika, the best in the world. You love it,
that
paprikash.
Is true.
Paprika, well, paprikash with extra paprika. Delicious.
Have you ever had that?
I have not. I need to get out.
Yep. Well, I can recommend a place to you. You might be from, it's called Sylvia's out in Enfield. It's a very ethnic restaurant.
I haven't been there, but it's on my list. Okay. Actually, I have one more spot to go before there, and then where Sylvia's is next.
So why don't we all go?
I think we should.
You be prepared to be treated like you were actually probably in Hungary or some...
Can we bring bull's blood?
Actually, I think they might have that on the menu.
See?
And they have a really eclectic wine list, as you would expect. But the food is made right there. I mean, they serve big portions. I mean, you're getting some really...
Now, Sylvia's in Harlem. They don't have paprikash. They have fried chicken.
That's right. Sylvia's in Harlem. I've actually seen some of her items actually in the store because she's marketed some of her stuff.
I got to tell you, the first time I went to Sylvia's, there she was right at the podium. Greeting everyone, just
really?
Like, yeah, it was pretty interesting.
Wow.
Yeah.
I have a restaurant question for you.
Okay.
What is the hardest restaurant to get into in the United States? The answer might surprise you. I know you know a lot of restaurants and there's a lot of popular ones.
I do.
It's on the East Coast, not the West Coast.
I would think, I wouldn't know. If I had to guess on the East Coast, it would either be Per Se in New York City or Husk in South Carolina, one or the other.
Any guess on your part? I'll tell you one thing, it's in New York.
Really?
It is in New York.
All right, well, you know what? One of the places I went to in New York that I took my family that I liked was the Palm. But that's kind of a...
Well, I'll just go right through.
I'm a big fan of the Palm, but go ahead.
It is Rao's.
Rao's?
It is Rao's.
Oh, for the meatball?
Because it's such a small restaurant and because it is so difficult to get in and most of their customers have been regulars for decades.
Right.
It's almost impossible to get in at all.
But however, they have a sister restaurant in Midtown.
Yes.
With the same recipes. So if you can't get into Rao's, go to the sister one. And let me tell you, those meatballs, delicious. They are so good. You put it in your mouth and it just disappears.
What is that? What makes a good meatball? The dissolving factor?
I think it's how you grew up. It's how your grandma or your mother made them. My mom made matzo balls. She didn't make meatballs. Well, she made meatballs too, but mostly matzo balls. And we always laughed because if they were too hard, we could bounce them on the ground and they would bounce up. But when she was on, they were tremendous.
Yeah.
But meatballs, I was there with a friend of mine and his dad before a Yankee game one time, and they were just phenomenal. It was just the best meatball.
So next to, I got to have a quiz for you guys.
Sure.
So next to Jordan's restaurant, the Pond House, where do you think is one of the toughest places, one of the best places to get food that's tough to find a seat?
In Connecticut?
Yeah, no, in West Hartford.
Oh, in West Hartford itself?
Yeah.
Probably Bobby P's house.
No, my house. My darling has the best mac and cheese.
Wait a minute. I've never heard about this.
I've never heard about it either.
Hey, listen, I'm telling you, it's...
No, Steve, I love you, man, but all the years I've known you,
which
you've
wine
never
goes
mentioned
good with,
that.
After, we'll go. But she's got mac and cheese.
If you drink wine with mac and cheese, yeah, you're starting off wrong.
Really?
You should have the coldest, crispiest beer you can have.
Okay, we could start with that then.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. Mac and cheese.
We're going to talk it's after the show, Steve.
We'll talk, yeah.
Now, I think before we wrap up tonight, because I want to go over quickly a few more other things. Jordan, is there anything coming up for you guys in the future?
Well, you know, Halloween is always really, really huge at the Pond House. We always decorate huge and big inside the building, outside of the building. It's just amazing what Lewis and Kim and the whole crew have done in West Hartford this year. We're starting to get ready. We're actually a month early right now, but everything is starting to come out, and we'll be putting the building together and all the decorations for Halloween together probably as we speak, actually. And so it's going to be amazing. We always have the Halloween brunch. And that's really all we have going on in October besides all the normal day-to-day rigors and all the parties. So.
Well, and I know Steve...
I got nothing going on.
You got nothing going on.
I got nothing. Right.
Well, I wanted to thank Steve again because, once again, you are the person who started this all.
You guys do all the lifting, so, you know.
You did suggest doing a show all those years back, 3 years now.
And how many shows have you done?
This is our 21st show, so we'll do a little toast to that at the end of the show.
We're of age.
There we go. Can we get these on DVD?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
And actually, if you had cable, you could watch the show.
I had cable, but being a fiscal conservative, I'm...
Sure you looked up to that Roku that I told you about, right?
Yes, I did.
Okay, I'm expecting you to get that.
Well, I'm doing the best I can.
So I wanted my people to please check out Jordan's restaurant, both in Glassbury or the Pond House in West Hartford. Check us out on Facebook. I'm going to put all these wines that you see tonight up. Have a great Halloween. And once again, be bold. Try some of these. Bring them to a party, because I know that... even though this particular Bubbles wasn't a Bubbles, I think it's still potential there.
Absolutely. Champagne cocktails.
Yeah. Though I don't like missing things with champagne unless I'm really not happy with it. So I'm going to hold off saying mixing that.
I'm going to hang around it more often.
I'm not happy with it. So champagne cocktails.
All right, well, once again, that's his opinion. Opinion is...
Or go and get it and see for yourself, and you be the judge and let us know.
I'll see you later, guys. I'm heading out.
Well, I want to thank everybody for watching. Again, everybody have a safe Halloween. Stay tuned for our next month's show, because there will be some more surprises for you also. And I want to thank Jordan again for being my co-host, and we're going to have him back as many times as he's willing to do the show.
Thank you, everybody.
So thanks for joining us. I'm Bobby P.
And I'm Jordan Stein.
And until next time, keep us all in
your wine cellar.